Blackstone Audiobooks presents The Hope Before Us by Elyse Larson.
We are going to win the war, and we are going to win the peace. The vast majority of the members of the human race are on our side. Many of them are fighting with us. All of them are praying for us. For in representing our case, we represent theirs as well. Our hope and their hope for liberty under God.
Franklin Delano Roosevelt, radio broadcast, December 9, 1941. Dedication. To our grandchildren, may our hopes become theirs. Richard Larson, John Larson, Evan Larson, Justin Larson, Jennifer Larson, Jeffrey Larson, Patricia Larson, Karen Linden, Jeremy Linden, Timothy Linden, Daniel Linden. Prologue, September 1944. Lieutenant Marge Emerson, U.S. Army Medical Corps, jumped from the landing craft into the waist-deep, icy surf and floundered behind the GIs toward Normandy Beach. The weight of her musette bag on her back nearly dragged her under. Cliffs above the beach offered no gunfire now, but wrecked landing barges and blasted-out trucks still rose from the shallows and littered the sand. On the long floating docks to Marge's right, other landing craft disgorged army trucks, tanks, ammunition, barrels of gasoline, and all the supplies that the invading army needed to conduct war. Marge had been ordered to France to join a field hospital team. Back in Wales, when she had pressed for investigation of an apparent suicide, she had unwittingly stumbled into a carefully laid plan to break up a Nazi spy ring in Britain. To protect her and their secret operation, the British Secret Service had spirited her away from Gilwern Military Hospital under cover of night. Sworn to secrecy, she hadn't said goodbye to friends, and she'd been ordered not to write to anyone. Letters to her would be detained so that no one could trace her whereabouts. It was bad enough that her friends would worry about her, but what her sudden disappearance would do to her parents and her sister Em really troubled Marge. She sloshed onto the wet sand looking for the person who would take her to St. Mary Glee's evacuation hospital, where she was to link up with the team of nurses headed for Belgium. The soldiers with whom she'd landed formed into lines and marched to waiting trucks. She stood at the water's edge, uncertain which way to go.
"Lieutenant Emerson! Lieutenant Emerson!"
a man's voice called. She turned toward the dock. A tall soldier jogged toward her. He came at an easy run across the packed sand and halted a couple of paces from her. Saluting, he said,
"Sergeant David Llewellyn, ma'am. I'm your driver."
She returned his salute and glanced at the insignia on his shoulder.
"You're not medical corps." "No, ma'am. Infantry. 1st Division. I'm a medic. I'm returning from a week's R&R in Paris. When the CO said there was a nurse who needed to be picked up, I volunteered. Rescuing is my specialty, and I figured you might need rescuing after coming across the channel with all those Joes eager to make points with a nurse."
She laughed. "Sounds like you've been in the army for some time."
"Yes, ma'am. My jeep is over yonder."
Without requesting permission, he lifted her wet bag from her shoulders. Startled because military women were supposed to carry their own bags, she said, "Well, thanks."
"You're welcome. A lot of army rules go against my grain. I was surprised they landed you in the water like the guys. It's a wonder you didn't have to swim for it, you being down there a foot shorter."
"They said the docks must be used for unloading supplies." Then she laughed. "I'm only a foot shorter than you. Most of the men don't reach your elevation. You must make a large target on the front lines."
So they tell me. I figure I'm also a good cover for the boys.
She studied his face and saw no hint of bravado or bragging.
That doesn't seem to worry you.
No, ma'am, he said quietly.
The sun's reflection from the sand shined upward on his face, softening the shadow cast by his steel helmet. His craggy features seemed to glow. He reminded her of a guardian angel statue back home on the campus of the hospital where she'd trained.
How did you come to be a medic? She asked.
I'm a conscientious objector, ma'am. I don't hold with killing.
Is this a matter of your faith?
Yes, ma'am.
They had reached the jeep. He tossed her bag behind the seat and moved to the driver's side while she climbed into the passenger seat. With a roar and minimal spinning of wheels, they headed for the road at the base of the cliff to join the line of supply trucks rolling inland. Marge took care not to stare, but found her eyes returning to his profile repeatedly. She had nothing but respect for conscientious objectors who risked their lives to save lives. She wished he'd say more about his convictions, but he drove silently as they ascended a ravine and moved into farmland divided by tall, battle-torn hedgerows. Something about Sergeant Llewellyn.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.